Hi everyone, I'm Kadambari Sahu. I'm the head of design at Valilad. Design Inspire is a web series of passionate, innovative, and young inspiring designers. The web series dive into their passion, inspiration, and what makes them go. It's an effort to understand how they are navigating their career path and how they are investing their creative energies. We believe hearing their bold moves and inspiring stories will ignite interest and inspire the next generation of budding designers across the globe. So let's go forward. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Design Inspire. Our guest today is Deshna. Deshna is a visual artist with a passion for photography, design, writing, and curation. A graduate of Sir JJ School of Arts, followed by a master's in graphic design from London College of Communication and master's in visual communication from Royal College of Arts in London. She moved back to India seeking to find meaning within her own design practice. This led to the inception of Studio Anugraha, which serves as a platform to encourage and undertake collaborative practices in the field of visual art, design, and research. It derives from and contributes to elusive aspects of culture, philosophies, and ideas in general. So welcome, Deshna. How are you doing today?
I'm fine, thanks, Kadambri. Thank you for having me.
So the format of the show, I'll talk a little bit about that, and then from there we will begin. So the first part of the show would be where you take, anything that inspires you, motivates you, you're passionate about, and, talk about that as a presentation. Followed by that would be a session where I asked you questions about your design journey. And the questions today, which are collated, are from the user experience group at Value Labs. They've gone through your profile and they've, they're curious to know about your work. So they've collated that and I'll be asking that. But before that, we're very excited to see your presentation. So let's go forward and do that. Over to you, Deshna.
Thanks, Kadambari. Thank you for having me. I'm just going to screen share and begin. I'm going to take this opportunity to talk about one of the largest projects that we've worked on in our studio. It's been a commission to... It's a commission to document the Kumbh Melas. The reason I've picked up this project is because it's kind of exposed us to a gamut of processes which we've sort of learned along the way. And now in hindsight, we use a lot of them in some of the projects that we are currently working on. And it's also helped us to define a niche, which is design for documentation, which is what our studio focuses on. And we hope to do more work in this genre. So to start off with, we had a patron who sort of came by and said, we'd like books and a film on the Kumbh Mela. And this was back in 2012. And the Kumbh Mela was approaching in January of 2013. So at that point, I had just graduated from the Royal College of Art and hadn't yet figured what I was going to do, whether, freelance or work for someone or start a practice. But because this commission came, my sort of set up and start practice was we had somebody who invested and sort of believed in us. So I won't go to the, we can talk about the backstory of that later, but now I'll take you all through the processes we engaged with to document the Kumbh. So the visuals you're now seeing are the Kumbh of Allahabad that happened in 2013. So if some of you may be aware of the Kumbh as a, festival or a gathering, but basically it happens in four places, in Allahabad, Ujjain, Nasik, and in Haridwar. And it happens mainly around water bodies, around rivers, which are holy and worshipped. That is a sort of a very peripheral explanation, but for the sake of time, I'm moving ahead. So what our team did was to take this head on, because we are not really, any experts on Hinduism, neither are we historians, and neither do we have any background of or understanding of the Kumbh. In fact, for most of the team, this was the first time that we even visited the Kumbh, and we were expected to make books and a film. So it was important for us to think through how we were doing this. And the only way we could do this is, adopt a sort of understanding and approach more in the zone of ethnography and anthropology, and look at premises that oral historians sort of, imbibe and navigate with. Because that's the only way we could document and produce something of some authenticity. So I'll go on to talk about that a little later, but we essentially, the mode of documentation was spending time on field through the duration of the gathering. So in Allahabad in 2013, we spent 60 days on field. The season was, it was winter, and our approach for documentation was more experiential. In Nasik, we spent 65 days. It was the rainy season. Our approach for documentation was more factual. And in Ujjain, we spent 9 days. It was summer, and our approach was anecdotal. So when I say experiential, factual, and anecdotal, these approaches also are emergent. They were not pre-planned, but they were emergent from the constraints that we had to document. We were asked to do books and a film, but our client gave us a free hand on how we approached it and what we produced. So as we go along, I'll talk through how these emerged. You are seeing some visuals now of, this is the most crowded day at the Kumela of 2013. And this is the Shahi Snan procession where people go towards the river for the holy bath. And I think close to 50 million people traversed the landscape of the Kumbh, which is 50 square kilometers around both the banks of the Ganga, the Sangam, on this particular day. And it is estimated that 80 million people visited the whole through its duration of 22 months. So now, how did we do this? It is a complex space. It is too many people. How do we document such a gathering, and how do we even navigate this or fathom this ourselves? So the only way, like I said, was to approach it in the methods or in the lenses that oral historians would adopt, which is through conversations with people experiencing it in real time. So essentially what this means is that, say if you are a government officer who's in charge of the health and sanitation at the Kumbh, if I go and arrangements for that particular Kumbh, you're responsible in contributing to how this unfolds at that time. So what you tell me will be of value because your presence is making things happen in a certain way. So this way, we went and interviewed essentially people who were experiencing it in real time, but were also contributing to the landscape in a powerful way, which contributed to how it even unfolded that, for that particular year. And then our client told us, right, the client's brief was that make a book. But now, as we all know in the design space, that's not enough of a brief because you need to have some sort of positioning. You need to have some sort of a, you know, purpose within the larger commission to make one, because there are so many books and films that exist on the Kumbh Mela. So why make another one, you know, and why put one out there like that? So we did about a month and a half of secondary research before we went, which is looking at whatever we could get hold of in terms of documentaries and existing books. And where we found a gap really was that there were so many books which were coffee table books, which were very image heavy and, you know, done by photographers, etc. They were brilliant, like visually they were all brilliant and they communicated beautifully, but they were not very contextualized. So I'm just seeing image after image and there are captions, but it doesn't give me more stories than that. And then there was the other extreme, which are very scholarly books. So like they are, you know, expounding philosophies of Hinduism, they have Sanskrit annotations, and it's quite heavy, they're dense. So unless I'm genuinely interested in the subject matter, I wouldn't really pick up those books. So this is where we found a gap. So there is this whole zone of, really visual coffee table books, and there's this other zone of very scholarly text heavy books. So we wanted to position this in between. And the reason to do this was also because our client's main intention of doing this was that we want people to experience the Kumbh. And according to them, a lot of young people in our country or even otherwise, they look at the Kumbh as a gathering which is, you wouldn't willingly go to. It's like a stampede, or it's so massive that, you know, why would you willingly put yourself in that situation? So while that is also true, and there is no going away from that for the kind of scale it is, but there is also a lot that goes on, which has a lot of potential to, teach in different ways, or there are life lessons, there are lessons of all sorts that the landscape offers. So he literally said that, you know, if through this book or through this film, if you are able to bring people to go to the Kumbh of your age, then you've succeeded. So literally that was the base of the brief, and we had to plan everything around it. So going back to positioning, we said we'll make this book which is fully contextualized. So while there'll be images and there'll be text, but the images will support the text and vice versa. And we are going to do it through storytelling, which the stories will be extracted, or the insights will be extracted from conversations. So I'm just rolling a few pictures of the Kumbh. So this is the scale. You see, these are pontoon bridges that connect the left and right bank. These are temporarily about 1.5 kilometers long, which are deployed. Around 23 of them are deployed just for the duration of the Kumbh. And these are the kind of settings that we are photographing in at all points of the day and night. So one of the things that we talked about before going was that, you know, there is this massive gathering, but then what makes it massive? What makes the scale what it is? It is the individuals that will come together to form the collective, right? So we were interested in these individual stories that form the collective. Now, we did it in two ways. One was through conversations and the other was through observations. And as people documenting, we were also going to be publishing. So people who are publishing and are documenting, we have the responsibility of archiving and also evidencing. Because, you know, it's not like a travelogue where, you know, we go and say, okay, it's beautiful, or, you know, it's the scale is enormous, and it's not filled with adjectives, because that's really very subjective to our own opinions. Whereas we wanted to put in information that sort of creates a connect and is authentic in a way that it supports the objective unfolding of the event. So observations were sort of evidenced in photographs, and conversations were evidenced in really voice recording, video recording, and taking stills of people we spoke to. And as an archive now, we have all of these in the studio that are that form the bibliography of the published volumes. So what you're seeing on my screen is essentially an example. This is a milkman. Now, this is the Shastri Bridge that connects the two banks of the river, the Ganga, and in Allahabad. And what we observed was 6 to 6:30 in the morning, if you go onto the bridge, you will see that a lot of milkmen come. They put a measure of milk into the river and then they go by. This is not a very normal happening outside of the Kumbh. It's mainly during the Kumbh. Now, this is their way of offering into the, you know, offering the river their measure of milk or their homage, whatever it is. So I'm just taking some visual examples for now. Then this is a Baba that we encountered. He called himself a scooter Baba. And we were surprised because we saw a lot of people going down to him. And he's riding this candy striped scooter, right, in the landscape. And we were really like amused what was going on. And we spoke to him and he said, you know, my way of serving people is really to make people smile. Serving God is to make people smile. So by dressing up the way I dress up every day, people want to take photos with me. They look at me and it brings a smile on their face. So that's why I'm here and this is what I'm doing. So there were stories like this. Now, this is not something you see in books on the Kumbh or films on the Kumbh. It's really something that we were encountering ourselves, and it was emerging from our experience of being on field. So this forms a photo story, a character story in the book. Then another visual evidenced photo story in the book is we saw women garlanding the bridges, the pontoon bridges. So they are having these huge balls of, you know, garlands, and they are chanting and they are garlanding bridges. Initially, we are wondering what is going on. But then we realized on talking to them that for them, they worship the river as goddess. And when the river is worshipped as goddess, the closest they can get to the river without contaminating it is really garland the bridge. So for them, that is their way of worshipping. So again, this is something that was very evidence-based. The visual tells the story. We just support it with the conversation that we had. I won't get into this. These are diary notes, but our books had mostly everything was evidenced through an objective, which is an objective viewpoint, which is somebody on field or something that is seen. But one component in each of the volumes was a diary note, which was a team sort of an anchor. I'll talk about this a little later. This is a diary note scribble. And then there were also the funnier sort of aspects. So at the Kumbh, so many people, it's the largest human gathering on earth. So like with all religious sites, globally, you see that, you know, as a form of worship, people put coins in the river. Now, during the Kumbh Mela, so many coins, right? So many people. So these are kids of boatmen who live there. And come evening, like at dusk, you'll see so many of them flinging magnets into the river and fishing out the coins. So this is on the lighter side. But again, these were things we never had any direction, or we never preempted to find them. We found them. And the documentation is really a post of what we found. It was just about being open and absorbing all that we saw. This is Andrew, who was an Australian that had come into the Kumbh that time. And for him, he wanted to serve in this landscape. He had come to a Kumbh which was 12 years before this Kumbh. And for him, he thought this is a great platform to homeschool children because it has so many insights and philosophies from all that is going on around. And the next time he came, which was in 2013, he wanted to be a contributor to the landscape, not just a receiver. So he is a boat builder in Australia. So he actually came to Allahabad the month before. He built a boat. The boat's name is Karuna. And he was ferrying people up and down the Ganga for free. That was his way of, you know, participating in the landscape for the value he saw in it. And then, of course, the Kumbh has so many aspects to it. One of the aspects is to serve, seva. So people who believe in the karmic philosophy in Hinduism, for them, this is like the karma bhumi to serve. Like you earn your brownie points in the form of good karma by serving and not expecting in return. But in a way, it's intangible that it, you know, adds up to your karma. So you see langars of all sizes and shapes feeding 5 lakh people to 5,000 people to 50,000 in all numbers, free food everywhere, and people incessantly cooking. This camp of about 50 ladies from Punjab, very poor families, farmers, day and night, they are making rotis. They make something like 75,000 rotis in a day to feed people. So moving on to the more serious insights. So these are formal. This was the Mela Adhikari for that particular Kumbh. And we had all these formal conversations as well. He's the head of security and traffic control, Kavindra Pratap Singh. And he was talking to us about all the crowd management policies that they had deployed. Example of one was, you know, a stoppage at one point means a stampede at another point. So he said that for us, all our ground staff is instructed in a way that to make sure there is constant circulation. Because if there is a stoppage somewhere, it might potentially mean a stampede elsewhere. So even if they had to direct people sometimes to the wrong direction, they would do that. But they have to make sure that there's constant flow. So this is one of the 25 crowd management strategies that they had. So these serious conversations brought out all of these insights that helped the functioning of this landscape. So I'll kind of skim through. There are a lot of stories. There's close to around 50 different insights and stories that are even visual based, but I don't have time right now. He's head of health and sanitation. And he said, you know, the things that were striking was that for us, it's not about, the challenge is not to build toilets for, you know, so many people. The challenge was to make sure people defecate in them, because more than 60% of the people attending the Kumbh are from rural India. And they are not used to having toilets in where they live. So they had to deploy staff to make sure that people defecated in them and not outside them. So it's a very different kind of landscape where problems are very different and it needs solutions that sort of speak a different language. These are academics at Allahabad University, head of anthropology, head of ancient history, head of ancient languages. And all these people have seen more than 4 or 5 Kumbhs through their life. And we interviewed all of them as natives of Allahabad, but also specialists in their fields. So they had a lot of stories and contribution that formed the that formed the documentation. So in Allahabad, we had 80 conversations. Now that was on field. Now off field, how do you sort of put all of this together? I'm going to stop sharing here and kind of move to another quicker presentation. So here I'll talk to you all about the whole thing of information design. Now, so what we've seen so far was on field. What you see on my screen is 8 books that are published, which is what the outcome was, and a documentary, which is an hour long. So these 8 books are from the documentation, and they are printed and published by the studio. How did we come to these? Our commission was one book, but as we started putting things together, we went to the client with a 8 book draft and said that, look, this is what we've come up with. Now we'll edit it down to further make it 3 or 2 or whatever. But our patron was quite happy with this, and he said he wanted to publish them, you know, as this, as 8 volumes. How did we arrive at these 8 volumes? So I talked to you all about the Allahabad Kumbh right now. We also documented the Nasik and the Ujjain Kumbh. So in all, we have 275 conversations on field from people from different gamuts of life ranging from, you know, saints, Akhada members, government officials, pilgrims, academics, writers, philosophers, all sorts of people interviewed. And they form the voices. We call them the voices of our books, because essentially all the content comes from them. We as a team are playing the role of facilitators to extract the content, and curators who are sort of piecing the content in a way that is receivable in the form of books. So Allahabad has 80 conversations. So all of these people's profiles are mentioned in the beginning of the book. And whatever they've said is sort of in the books. But how did we come up with this grouping? So essentially, like with anything that we now do, we tag photos, we tag content. We tagged all of these 80 conversations for various categories that they offered. So say I spoke to you at the Kumbh, and you may talk to me about your faith, and you may talk to me about, say you are a government official, you will talk to me about how security was deployed. So then I'm tagging your interview, one for faith, one for security, and various other aspects you may have spoken of. So that way, every interview was tagged. We, at the end of tagging, we had around 100 tags. Then those 100 tags, we started grouping, and we grouped and grouped till we couldn't group any further. And those groups are really these: place, time, astronomy, history, mythology, belief, Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati, Seva, Sadhana, Satsang. So these essentially have emerged from tags. That's why we describe our process as self-organization and emergence. It's not pre-directed. It's emergent from what we've exposed ourselves to, or what we find in the landscape. And why trios? We had this idea that, the Allahabad Kumbh, the iconic thing about it is that it happens at the Sangam, which is the confluence of the Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati. So all Kumbhs happen at their respective rivers, like Godavari for Nasik, Shipra for Ujjain. But here, Allahabad iconic is that it's at the confluence. So we wanted to make sure that something in the book stands out as the Sangam. Then it's iconic to Allahabad. So that gave us an idea that if we keep one book as Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati as a trilogy, then it offers us more sort of systems to have trilogies as tags. So we would then, so we grouped in a way then that we got tags of threes, and that also allowed us more sort of accommodation, because it gave us 24 instead of 8 for 8 books. So that's how the grouping happened, and that's where the idea came from, again, emergent. So now the books are 8 in number, and say, you talk to me about the river and the rituals around the river, your faith, what you think of the security, then you will be in book 3, which is about river and rituals. You'll also be in book 7, which is about faith. And you'll also be in book 8, which is about, you know, the security, the services that are offered, and the melaness of the mela. So the same person would make it his way or his voice into the various books based on what he or she has said. So the books are really by subject, because now when we think of receiving of the books, as a reader, I don't care what, you know, Kavindra Pratap Singh said, because I don't know who he is. But I care about wanting to know about security and crowd management, policies or strategies. So in that way, the receiving was thought of, and therefore the segregation was done by subjects. And also what this kind of helped us in responding to our client's brief, because he said, I want people to come and experience the Kumbh. He didn't say, I want people to develop faith, or neither did he say that I want to promote religion. He said, I just want people to come to this landscape because it does different things to different people. Somebody may take lessons of management from it. Somebody may see the power of collective energy. Somebody else may be interested in the rivers. or astronomy, anything. Somebody wants to just experience the idea of serving and free food. Somebody wants to experience philosophies and teachings of gurus. So in this way, the 8 books kind of answer one question each, which is a different entry point into the landscape. So say I'm somebody who's an atheist and who has nothing to do with philosophy or religion, then book 8 is a book that will help me to get an idea of the services that the landscape offers. Because there's nothing religious about that book. It's only the services and the melaness of the mela, which is what the book 8 is about. So this division helped different entry points into the landscape, and it attracts different kinds of readers with different interests. So this was the aspects, and visually we've given a color attribution to it. And then everything on field was really interviews, which was a Q&A. But in the books, we've created 8 different styles of writing, again, from different people who are contributing to the making of the book. And each book has 8 different styles of writing, and they are represented by flags. So why flags? Because the Kumbh as a landscape sees a lot of flags. So if you are at a vantage point and you see the landscape, you will see flags of all shapes and sizes. Flags will help you to help act as unifiers, but at the same time separators. So in that way, they're very important as a visual component. So we've just graphically drawn from that thought. And for our information design system, we've used different flags for different styles of writing. So moving ahead, this is the map of Sangam, which you see a lot in all the billboards, etc. at the Kumbh. So this is a very familiar shape when you are in that landscape. So we've used it metaphorically to navigate our 8 books. So this is essentially 8 colors, which is 8 aspects. And there are 8 flags, which is 8 styles of writing in each book. And when the two are juxtaposed together, you get the contents for all the 8 books to navigate. This is a spread in book 3 as you enter. So you are in book 3 and it's positioning you within the whole map of where you are. And how this translates further is really, so this is the juxtaposed map. So this gives you all the 8 books ka contents. So there is one generic book, which is like an inventory or a lead into how do you navigate the 8 books. This is how it is designed. And this is, now these are, you'll find these at the footer of each book. So right now you're in book 3, which is blue in color, which is about the rivers. And on every page, based on what the page is, you'll find this symbol and color. So that's how it anchors the information design. So you just looking at the footer on every page, you will know, okay, you're on this book and you are now reading poetry. So that's how it is designed, essentially. So yeah, and of course, there are more graphic components to it, which considering we are a communication design studio, I've skipped a few steps in between about, archiving, etc., because I don't have so much time. But just taking you through the slides quickly to sort of, this is the flags and where our inspiration comes from. And then a display font was also created for the book. I think I have a teammate by the name of Carol who may be on this call, and she's the one who's diligently done the display font. So yeah, these are spreads from the whole book. These are some inside page layouts from book 1. This is examples of the display font that's created. And then there are other layers of design that are used. So every photo story inside has a blue title and a yellowish background. Every character story has a red title and a gray background. So these are smaller intricacies as designers that are there in the book. These are more spreads. These are the kinds of writing. So like say Scooter Baba makes his way into character story. This is a diary note. I don't have the time to explain. This is a photo story. This is a poetic extract. So this is expressed in the form of poetry. These are left in as interviews from conversation. And then just last point I'll mention is publishing. Like I told you that our studio published these books. And because of having to publish, it was important for us to get NOCs. No objection certificates from every individual who contributed to this who was the voice who we interviewed, who contributed to the book. While we spoke to them, we had obviously told them that we will be, you know, publishing, and with their consent only we had asked and talked to them. But like with a lot of things, you know, translation can cause discrepancies. Our conversations on field were a lot in Hindi. Then we worked with transcribers and translators off field. And also in the way our books were designed, the same person's content was kind of split into different books based on what that person, he or she, spoke about. So we found that it would be ideal and responsible on our part to show them how people appeared in the books before we published. And it was better to get a formal return acceptance because we were acting as publishers. So tomorrow morning, we don't want somebody to wake up and be like, look, we didn't mean that when we said that, or you've contextualized it in a different way. So this process is something we didn't anticipate at all. But it took us 6 months from making the book draft ready and to publishing, just because it took us that long to get all the NOCs. Because these are people who don't necessarily have email IDs. They are on the move, especially the saints. And even some of them are from villages. So to access them, we had to physically courier things. We had to email some. We had to send people to Allahabad to... from the client, and who went and chased and found people and got their NOCs. But we had to extract each person's part and how it appeared in whichever book and make PDFs and make booklets and say that, look, you appeared 1, 2, 3, 4 places. This is what is before you. This is what is after you. Please have a look. If everything is okay, please sign the NOC and we'll publish. So while we got some, most of them, it was quite, we have quite a few of these detective stories. So this is one example. You see that this is a lady who we interviewed in the Kumbh. She's a sadhvi and she had an ashram in Madhya Pradesh. And we couldn't trace her. We had asked, I mean, we had taken her address and her phone number, everything, but the address didn't exist. Nobody was answering the phones. The couriers bounced back. And she was amongst the only one that we didn't have an NOC. And it was risky for us as a studio because we have 79 out of 80. And even if she woke up one day and said that, look, you know, this is not how I would like you to publish or me, then we would have to pull down the whole publication. So thankfully, in the process of trying to find a way to, you know, get in touch with her, Teetha, my other colleague from studio, who's also maybe on this call, she had the presence of mind to zoom into this background image that you see of her pandal, which describes her ashram and her setup. And in that, we found the number of the flex guy who printed this. And we called him up and we tried to ask him about, you know, if he knew about the whereabouts of this lady, and he did. Their ashram had shifted, so he gave us the right address, and that's how we got the NOC. And then, you know, we had all of them to publish the book. So we have a few stories like this, which are also there prior to publishing, which we didn't anticipate really. So this is how the books are packaged. And the project has been exhibited in different places. This is at the launch at the Nehru Center in Bombay. That's how it looks. And the twofold information architecture helped. So our books were by subjects, but our exhibit was by styles of writing. So on one wall were all the interviews, on one wall were all the photo stories, because it just helped the spatial ergonomics of going through. So people who want to read less are concentrated in one area. People who want to read more, they are concentrated in one area. That's how the exhibition was designed, and the information architecture helped that. This is at the Goa International Photo Festival, which was our first preview of the project. This is at Indian Institute of Human Settlements in Bangalore and in Sumaya Lifelong Learning Center. At the Venice Biennale, we were fortunate to send in footage from the Kumbh. So there was a pavilion by the name of Dust Permanence Matter, which was Rahul Mehrotra, the architect's pavilion. And his work, he and his team, he heads urban planning at Harvard, and he and his team were in the same Kumbh landscape, sort of documenting the Kumbh from a different built architectural standpoint. And in Venice, he was invited to exhibit, and we had people stories, whereas they had all the factual stuff. So we were able to contribute people stories in the form of footage that was exhibited in Venice. So these are some slides from the Venice Biennale, where they tried to recreate the whole pavilion in a way that the Kumbh actually is, with bamboo and fabric. How you see the tents. Yeah.
Hi, Deshna. A quick time check. We are at 35 minutes.
Okay, awesome. So So this is it in terms of the Allahabad Kumbh. We also did Nasik and Ujjain, and I was able to kind of take you all through, you know, how the system was derived, the information design and navigation was done in Allahabad. But we have a completely different system that we came up with. Again, not what we came up with, but what the information that we got offered. And it's a whole different way of navigating the books, where we've used, you know, common nouns, proper nouns and abstract nouns as a way to dissect information and put relevant visuals to it. So for all common nouns, we used vector illustrations. For all proper nouns, we used photographs. And for all abstract nouns, we used patterns. And how these three come together to form the design of the whole book. So yeah, in a sense, every book project that we've done, which gives us the scope of on-field documentation to convert it into a deliverable, like a book or a film, we are trying to spot systems and see how these systems can help in navigating complex information and make that information more receivable. So I think that's what we love doing in the studio. And I speak for a team of several people, and I represent them, because all of these projects are massive in size and cannot by any means be one person. So although I'm the face of them, a lot of hard work is put in really by the team that is in the studio and our collaborators that make it happen. Sorry, I exceeded time.
No, that's okay. I think it's wonderful, you know, the kind of work that you've done. It's really insightful, and I think it's a shame that it cannot be, like, you know, totally gathered on, because it's so big and we could not, you know, sort of get more of it. But yeah, I think some of it we will, you know, sort of look at it in the question and answer. So I'll start with your design journey. You did talk about it a very little, but I would like to know, like, how did you even think of becoming a designer, and how did it start for you?
Okay. So I think I was, I mean, as an student, my dad's an architect, and I saw a lot of, you know, his kind of work around me all the time. And I did my 11th, 12th science, because at that point we needed to do science to do architecture. So that option was kept open, and I did it. But at the end of it, I realized that I was more drawn to, you know, design and art. And that's how I applied in JJ and got through. And then it was sort of in JJ, we had, I think it's still like that even now, but in your third and fourth year, you pick up a specialization. And I specialized in typography at that time. And then we were exposed through our tutors to, you know, experiences outside of the country, or not exposed to the experiences, but we were people would talk to us about it. We had, at that point, Curious Design Yatra had just started, and, you know, we were exposed to some of the things happening outside. And that's when this thought of wanting to study further, and then London College of Communication was an obvious choice to pick, because it had graphic design, and that's what I wanted to pursue and specialize in. And then I was fortunate to meet my design mentor in London, who is by the name of Michael Wolf, whom some of you may know. He's the founder of Wolf Hollands, the branding company. He's now in his 80s. I was very, very fortunate to have met him and been mentored through my design journey of 4 years in being in London, and he still continues to mentor and inspire me. He was the one who, you know, prompted me to apply to RCA, and he said, you know, it's a different experience and you should expose yourself to it if you have the opportunity. So I applied and got through, and then my parents were supportive to fund my tuition, because it's quite expensive. That's how RCA and the RCA experience happened. So yeah, that's been the design trajectory. And then after that, Manugra was set up in 2012, which is the year I came back from London. It's been 8 years. And because we've had the opportunity to document the Kumbh, which becomes a sort of a case study because of the kind of scale this project is, and also we immersed in it a lot. Now there's more opportunities to share it at places like NID with the publication design and documentation courses.
How do you go about, like, so how did you go about setting Anugraha? The Kumbh, as you know, it's really very massive, and documenting it would have been like a difficult task, a daunting one to even, you know, begin with. So how did you go about planning about it?
So like I said, it was a, so the root of that can be traced really to my dissertation at the London College of Communication. So when I was at LCC, I compared, as part of my major project, I looked at the cultural landscapes of the Ganga in Varanasi and the Thames in London. I did this cultural comparison, a semi-photojournalistic approach, and that manifested in the form of 5 books, but it was a school project. Mm-hmm. And then I went to RCA, and in RCA, I think all that I was exposed to was more of probing into you know, who I am and what do I want to pursue, or what do I want to make my design practice as. And at that point, I realized that for me, meaning or purpose was really in things that are cause-based. And I was interested in, you know, looking at things that were supporting or facilitating causes. So essentially NGOs, cultural institutes, because although they are physical entities, they are built around causes or ideas and things like that. So for me, I found meaning in those spaces and experiences, and I found myself inadequate to be one of those or to start an NGO or kind of support a cause. But I thought that why can I not use design to facilitate that cause? And that's how, through the churning at RC and my dissertation there, I decided that, you know, whenever the time is right for a practice, and that is what has happened now, that as a studio philosophy, we focus on working in cultural environmental medical sectors and artistic, which means we try not to work on luxury brands and directly on products that promote consumerism. Sometimes they're also a part, but they're more of a byproduct than the sole intent. And this is, of course, with due respect to all other ways of working. It's just something that I found resonance with and so wanted to pursue. So going back to your question of the Kumbh, how that happened was, I came back from RCA and I decided that I'm going to, you know, work, like I want to work in these zones. So at that point, this client came by and he is a builder, a patron who's who's commissioned us to document the Kumbh. They are builders, and he asked to design a building brochure. And I said that, you know, this is not the zone I really want to pursue now. I'd already come back after RCA, and I said I want to work more in the cultural space and whatever. So he was like, okay, show me some of the work you've done. And that time I happened to mention about the Ganga and the Thames dissertation at LCC. And that's when, because it's about the rivers and sort of photojournalistic, he got the thought that, you know, why don't you document the Kumbh? So that's really how the commission came about. And at that point, I was figuring whether I'll freelance or work for someone. And because the commission came and it wasn't a project that one can handle alone by any means, I thought it's a good time to set up practice. And Anugraha was born from that commission. The commission was before the studio was born, but we immediately set up. So my co-founders are two others, and both are from more of a commerce background, but they ran a design studio prior to co-founding Anugraha, and they focused, their expertise really is in print production, accounts, logistics. So it's actually everything that I can't do or I'm terrible at with the numbers, etc. So I had this vision and they kind of supported it. They believed in it. So they bring in all of the components that I cannot do. And so we complement, and that's how the studio was born.
Do you want to expand on the cause-based work that you do?
Sure. So far our clients really have been, we probably have worked for about more than 15 NGOs. And it's the same thing that a communication design studio would do, essentially branding, collaterals, you know, invites, posters, booklets, brochures, profiles. But it's really only for this sector, which is social, cultural, educational, environmental. So example of some of our clients really is, we work for the Impact Foundation at the Tata Memorial Hospital that works because of cancer for children. Or we worked for NGOs that are, you know, working in the zone of sex trade and how to kind of help women to divert professions or support them It's called Missing Link Trust that we recently worked with. Mm-hmm. So there's a whole gamut of basically, there's one called Young Volunteers Organization that brings in entrepreneurs to contribute small amounts and then chooses a cause every month to support. So that's the social sector. The cultural sector is museums, art galleries, really. So one of them that has been our long-standing client is Tark. We've been designing, Tark is an art gallery in Bombay, and we've been designing for them for the last 4.5 years now for all their shows and catalogs. And then the other focus has become commemoratives, volumes, because like the Kumbh, Design for Documentation, our clients, so we get like patrons who will say, okay, can you document 5 years life in the way his values are or in the way he's impacted society? So our briefs are like that, and then we have to go and meet all his stakeholders, all his office staff or wherever he's done his social work, and sort of put together content structures. And another example is over 130-year-old animal shelter in Nasik, which is spread over 200 acres, and it's family owned, and it's never been talked about or documented. But we spent 2 weeks on field interviewing the people who run it, and came up with a whole framework of man, cow, and land, and how that's cyclical and supporting the ecosystem for it to run sustainably, and put together as in the form of a book ultimately, but put together the whole system of operation in the form of infographics, then that further translates into a book. So it's become that two kinds of projects happen. One is where we are expected to go on field like the Kumbh and then convert something that is a physical entity or an event into a deliverable like a book or a film. And the other is like a normal, where the author may come or say a gallery will say that this is the artist whose work will be displayed, here all of the images, here are the texts. Now focus on, designing the catalog and the formats. We also work with print and production. So that's, again, a thing that we're trying to experiment with, different formats of books and collaterals that are produced. Yeah.
So in your presentation that you did right now, you talked about different methodologies, like, for example, experiential, factual, and, anecdotal. Can you expand on that?
Yeah, so I couldn't go through the other two Kumbhs, but basically, if you look at the Allahabad books now, although there is a contents and a certain way that it's structured, if you open one book and you seamlessly move into the next chapter without actually knowing really that you've gone into the next chapter, because one book will comprise of, it's almost like you're reading an interview, then you're seeing some images, which is a character story with little captions, then you're seeing a photo story, then you're seeing some quotes in the form of page breakers or insights. So it's a bit of a seamless experience in a way that you find yourself at the Kumbh. It's not very directed. It's something that you discover. So it's not like sort of saying that, if you want to find out about crowd management, go to page X in the book. It's almost like, oh, you read the security traffic control guy's interview and you'll discover it. So it's really in the way that you experience the landscape that you discover. A book offers that experience that as you read, you don't anticipate what you'll read. A larger head you anticipate, but smaller things you just discover as you read. So in that way, we try to recreate the experience of being at the Kumbh, be the experience of the books themselves as you navigate. So that is more, we call it experiential. When we say factual, Nasik documentation is done very differently. It's for volumes. But in that, we've interviewed 155 people. And what happens is, in the way it is written and designed, every single sentence is footnoted to say who said it. So you can trace every single sentence in the book to who said it and what role that person played. It's very fact-based. So for example, we have 14 interviews just of police personnel, from control rooms, from on the traffic control, on the security, on the crowd management. So we have a lot of data. And so the only way to kind of allow the reader to grasp all that is to attribute who's saying it, because sometimes it's even contradictory data. So we don't know how to validate, right? Like, how would we know that this is right versus that? So we put it all out there for the reader to decide based on who said it and the authenticity they associate. So when you look at the Nasik books, if you tell me, okay, can you tell me about how many people were in the Kumbh on this day? I can tell you which page number that's on. So that is very, very factually designed in a way that, you know, you can pinpoint sentences to find out certain information. And Ujjain is done very differently also because we had constraints of time and budget. So we were on field only 9 days and there were 45 conversations that we had. So every chapter name is really a name of a person. So it's like a little story or anecdote through the person's lens that you are experiencing the poem. So the three, I think, are more emergent. Again, not pre-directed or decided, but what with our constraints we could do. And Nasik is also the home ground for our client. Our client is based in Nasik. Which is also why we had a lot more access to, you know, people and the government officials, etc. So we could get more information. Yeah,
that was really insightful. You also touched upon, like, you know, the biases that creeps in into the research and point of view, unfiltered point of view somehow can get of designers into the, you know, the research. So how do you avoid these kind of situations and the biases?
So I don't know if I have an answer for that, except that just the awareness that it can happen constantly and also sort of vetting whatever we are producing with other people constantly. Because if, you know, one person is working on it throughout, then even unconsciously or subconsciously, that voice may become dominant. I'm saying voice of the team that's making it. Editor or whatever. So on all our books, we don't have like one editor, one writer. We have 4 or 5 different people who have contributed in different capacities in different times who are vetting all of it to kind of question or even ask where that content has come from or why have we curated it in a certain way. So more than one lens seeing it constantly. Mm-hmm. And also because we are sort of like we said that I know that there's no such thing as neutral because the questions you ask that itself defines a certain probing into the answer. So in that way, I don't think we have any answers in terms of being neutral. But the client brief was that for the Kumbh was really that you need to capture the essence. So now it's very easy for me to make a book on, you know, everything that goes wrong at the Kumbh. I have enough data for that also. Yeah. Because you are exposed to a landscape with both things happen. But the focus is again aligned to the brief because the client doesn't want us to make a book on everything that went wrong. He wants us to look at the essence of what it started out as and what carries on. So yeah. That becomes the anchor to kind of navigate all your questions around and also as a fallback that if I ask this question and someone said this, is it kind of confirming to the client brief in wanting to capture the essence? So yeah, I think that, and if you look at some of the things in anthropology or ethnography as modes of study, I mean, there are no literal methods that come to my mind, but it kind of trains you to think of how to take a step back and look at things that are in front of you in a way that is really not you. Mm-hmm. So to absorb without judging. And I think that's a constant quest for all of us in the team because we all judge, right? Even before we know we are judging everything around us. Mm-hmm. So to consciously think of, this is not about me or you, it's about them and their representation. So how are we in the truest way representing them? Which is also where I sort of say that our role is not of directors. Our role is of anchors and facilitators or curators, but not of authors or writers. We're not doing that.
I also want to because of the time constraint, we couldn't, literally go over the archival process. Do you want to walk us through that a little bit? How do you go about it?
Again, no rocket science, but everything on field is generally sound recorded, video recorded, and photographed in the form of stills. So typically for any conversation, we generally are 4 people from the team. There's an interviewer, there's a person who's just doing sound recording, somebody who's doing video, and somebody who's doing stills. And then people are given different responsibilities where, say, one person is making sure to ask the name, the place, the date, the time, like the basic diligently recording all of that, and also the contact, how do you get in contact back with you if I want to. So that is just on field, the basics. Then when we come back to studio, one thing, I mean, not studio, on field at the Kumbh every day at night, because you're meeting, say, 15 different people. And by the time you go on to the next day, you've completely forgotten who you met and what they said. So we do something called diary logging, which has to be done every day in the night before we move on to the next day, however late in the night. So it's really writing down the time and place of conversation, in a sense, 2-3 words of whoever from the team was present, what that conversation was about, and who from the team was present. Because again, when we translate later, we like that person present from the team to vet it, because translation can also change things. So this is done. So at the end, like, it took 2 years from on field to publishing this project of 8 volumes. So the whole day log, the diary log of all the 60 days really is the bibliography, because the book has no secondary research. Secondary research is only in the form of referencing for our knowledge, but nothing in the book is secondary. So the whole bibliography is really the primary research. And in the form of archiving, it's archived hard drives, and we have backups of that. And we try to keep, basically all archiving does it in a more sort of, now everything is on cloud, of course, and we have not yet done that, but we will eventually. But to kind of keep your set of hard drives not in the same location, or some, if preferably not even in the same city, to have that second, third backup in another city. So yeah, the basics are done in that. And everything is attributed. So in terms of, because it's also the role of publishing, we have to make sure that anything put out has a evidence, which is the archive.
Yeah. That's super helpful, in understanding the process, and it's really very diligently done, especially how you, approach people and, take an NOC from each and everyone, and the story that you told, that was really inspiring in that sense. So, the kind of work that you're doing, what is your source of motivation or conviction to follow the body of work that you do?
I think it's in that way, it's just where you find meaning. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty straightforward, as in that, if you like, say, music, you'll easily do things around music. Or if you like things around the sensory smells, you will pick up things around you that have that component, or you will start looking at how do you deal with this through what you like. So for me personally, I find meaning in causes and in cause-driven social, work, cultural work. And so it's easy for me to work in that zone. So actually I find myself in a privileged position, because a lot of people do what they don't like to do for their work. But for me, in that way, meaning, purpose, and work is all the same. It encapsulates what my aspirations are. Mm-hmm. It has not been the most easy journey, in a way that we do a lot of books, and books that get over in 2 days or even 2 months. They sometimes take 6 months or 2 years. Mm-hmm. So the turnout of deliverables in the studio is fairly slow. We don't have, things that get over in 1 day or 2 hours. Everything takes very long. So in that way, it does demand patience, but you know that you're working towards something larger all the time. So it involves a little bit of discipline and, sort of having your day deadlines or being driven, because otherwise you lose track of time, because they're such long projects, and you have to hold your own self as accountable. So you have to find ways to be accountable. And for that, what has helped me personally is really our studio team, because we all have our different strengths, and we work like pieces of a puzzle. So it's almost like if I do something, somebody else is designing, somebody else is illustrating, somebody else is checking the content, somebody else is layouting. So everyone is playing their roles, and in that way, if one person lags on time, the other gets affected. So it's almost like you keep each other motivated to respond to the larger timeline, and that helps to really keep going. But in going back to what you asked about the drive, really, it's something that resonates, and so it's easy. Yeah, it's challenging monetarily. It's challenging to keep doing that work, because it's work that where effort is the same for you may, you know, work for a consumer MNC and you'll get paid 6 times more for the same thing that you will get paid in the social sector, because that sector doesn't have that kind of funding. But then it's also kind of thinking of it as a lifestyle. So for us in the studio, everyone who's part of Anugra also, I feel, shares that vision, because they could well be in another studio paid double of what we pay, mm-hmm. doing the kind of work they're doing. But for them also, meaning lies in the work and the kind of work, and therefore they are there. Mm-hmm. That's what I believe.
So all of the work that you are doing are very research driven, right? And they've generally emerged. So how do you keep track of time, and specifically, you know, when there are deadlines which are stringent, how do you go about doing that?
I don't have a specific method, except that you back work, right? If you have a book launch, yeah. then that's your deadline.
Yeah.
Then it's also back working, because sometimes with these things, based on the time you have, you can go on and on. Like the same book you can make in 6 months, but you can also take 12 months if you have that much time. Yeah. So in that way, you just put a back constraint. When there's a deadline, it's great, because then at least that becomes the deadline. Like for us with the Kumbh, it was like, how we launch when the book is ready. So that dragged even more because there wasn't a deadline. So the positive of the deadline is that then it's all about back working and seeing in that constraint, what can you do? But yeah, day deadlines is important, because you have to have your plan saying that, okay, in, you know, 2 weeks, you have to finish all the transcribing. In 2 weeks, you need all the structures done. In 3 weeks, all the illustrations and the visual language. And then after that, you may say that, you know, we need to keep that client buffer of getting a response, like everyone does, and then fine tuning or proofreading, mm-hmm. and then checking for the NOC. So all of that, it's really the process just put into time slots, a longer timeline, of keeping a larger one in sight, and that's how we work.
Yeah. And that's amazing. So right now it's currently, you know, everybody is working remotely. How has that scenario impacted you, or has it?
I wish like my colleagues could answer that, but because I think each has their own way of taking it. And because a lot of our work currently is more digital also, I don't think we're that affected, because we can work remotely. But I have to say that, you know, the three people who are working in a creative capacity, we are a small studio, alongside me, have been with us for more than 5 years. So in that way, we know the processes, we share a comfort level, we know what to expect from each other and each other's strengths. So with remote working, that's very handy, because you really know how much time somebody's going to take to finish this. And if you need something done quicker, it's better to send it to her, because she's good at it, and vice versa. So I don't think it's, for us, it's been in that way productive enough. Although there are days when you have to, you know, kind of, I think, drive yourself and others. Because we are all in the situation of not only working anymore, we have errands to run at home and look after, which by going to a workspace, all of that was just done by somebody else or it did itself. But now you are exposed to all of that and you have to contribute to that. So I think flexibility of time has helped, as in earlier, if you're in an office space 9 to 5 or whatever, everybody is working in that time, which has its positive of co-creating, brainstorm, mind mapping, all that we miss doing physically. But now it's just saying that, okay, we need this much work done in a day or in 2 days. Then how you do it, really, you can't micromanage. Unless there's a deadline or there's a loop involved. But other than that, it's more like you want to work, you know, 2 in the night, it's fine. Whenever you want to work, but the work needs to get done. So I think that's how we're navigating.
Okay. As a designer, or, you know, creative person that you are, what inspires you? Film, books, anything? What are those things that really pushes you?
I love reading, and also I love books. So, again, I said I'm fortunate that I'm mostly designing books. So it's almost like a childhood thing where when I would visit a library or crossword, I would tell my mom that, you know, I wish to own this at some day or be a manager in this crossword, mm-hmm. because I love surrounding myself with books. But yeah, books essentially of all sorts, whether it's visual and design books or even stories or philosophy. I love philosophy, so any sort of philosophy, biographies, lives and works of literature inspire me. And I love drawing, but I'm not like an illustrator who can respond to great briefs. We have in our studio Carol, who's very good at that, and but I'm not that kind of an illustrator. But I love, say for example, I love drawing lotuses. So there was a point where before going to sleep every day at night, I would draw a lotus and, you know, put myself to bed because it's a good way of calming down. So yeah, I have my little, I think hand doing is something that we was inculcated in us from our JJ days, where, you know, we were expected to show up in college only after we had 50 sketches every morning for a long time. So in that way, with running the studio, I don't get that opportunity of doing things hands-on every day anymore. So I find other ways to doodle or draw lotuses and keep that as the hobby time.
Any recommendations for a book that inspires you?
Yeah, lots.
Yeah.
I can send a list, but there is, in terms of design, I think there's a great book by the name of How to Be a Graphic Designer Without Losing Your Soul. It's written by Adrian Shaughnessy, who was also a tutor at the Royal College of Art. And I love that book. It's almost like, although it's, I think it's written in 2005, which means it's 15 years old, but somewhere it's very contextual and open, that it's like a go-to to find answers sometimes when you're lost. So I use it like that. I recently read a book called The 5 AM Club by Robin Sharma, which I don't wake up at 5, but I would like to. But anyway, it's a great book of how to, you know, manage your life and your time. And your time is limited. So how do you channelize energy to what you really want to do and work around goal setting and things like that? And that's been an interesting book. I like haikus, and I like books on, you know, philosophies like Wabi Sabi. So a lot of Leonard Cohen is an author that's written this book, Wabi Sabi for Artists and Designers, which is a great book as well that I enjoy. And other than that, of course, you have the classics like The Art of Looking Sideways by Alan Fletcher, which are just like little spurts of inspiration in the middle of the day when you are stagnated or stuck. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, and blogs like Brain Pickings and Maria Popova. Of course, it's all books, but in a digital medium, that also is just a difference in medium that way. But that's, again, a great blog that has fueled a lot of thoughts and inspiration. And send you a list.
Some advice for young and budding designers. That's part of it.
I'm not sure if I'm in any advisory capacity, because I think I'm learning along the way every day as well. But I think what I can only speak for what's helped me, and what's really helped me is to really find meaning and purpose in what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. And that's also a constant quest. It's not like every day you can just do what you like. It has its struggles within it, but just that when you have a larger kind of a anchor or a purpose that you are responding to for your own self, then work becomes much more than work. As in, it's easier to work, and it's also because it's just a resonance of how you are and who you are. Mm-hmm. And it helps to, so I feel like our design schools in India especially, and it's changing now, but especially in my time when I was studying in JJ, etc., a lot of emphasis was put on formats. So like, okay, you're a typographer, you're an illustrator, or, you know, you are a UI UX designer. So we all have our skill sets, and that's needed. Like, I can design books quickly, so that pays my rent. I know my skills are in InDesign. So we all need those skills. But I think the other gamut, which is thinking of our own selves and our own perspectives from a content perspective, is also important. Mm-hmm. So it's as easy as this, that say if you are a cricket fan, if you were to make a book or a film on cricket, I'm sure it will be better than somebody like me who has no interest in cricket. But very often I am the one who's commissioned to make a book on cricket, because people are like, she makes books, so let's go to her. But nobody is looking at subject resonance, whereas I feel like that can potentially play a huge role. So now when somebody comes with say a jewelry brand to design, I'm not going to be able to do justice, because my heart doesn't lie there. I don't know anything about it. But on the other side is, if somebody comes to me with an NGO or, you know, a cultural museum or something like that, because I've kind of pursued that and I like that, I also have the experience in doing that over and over again, I will respond to it much more powerfully. So I feel like as designers, if we not only think about the formats we are working in, but what resonates with us as human beings, and therefore to see how we can even create spaces or studios or work environments that are not only thinking by formats, they're thinking also by subject matters or larger, broader context. So let's say a design studio is only doing work for education sector. And if they do that for 10 years, imagine how good they'll get at it. And say somebody who's graduating has really done their research in working for a school or working in for Teach for India, whatever. So they would find a fit in that kind of a space. So I'm not saying that it's viable to do only that, but I think a balance of that would be nice.
Thank you for sharing your thought. I'll take right now just one question which seems to be there here from the team, which says that did you have to reject any brand client because of your values related to consumerism? If yes, how did you handle the situation?
Yeah, lots. I think I've said more no's than yeses. But again, like I said, that it's we exist or we can do the work we're doing because of CSRs that exist. And the CSRs that exist because the mainstream exists. So in that way, it's all a loop. It's all interconnected. One feeds into the other. So there's no going away. It's just like saying that, you know, you can do something better. So you choose to do it. So in that way, when you communicate to a client saying that, I'm not designing for you because I don't like what you're doing. It's just that my inclination is more towards this and I'm better at this. So I'd rather focus on this because I can't do you justice with what you're asking me to do. So I think the when you maintain that modest tone, and it's not modesty that's born out of trying to be modest, but it's the reality. Like today, if you tell me to do a jewelry brand, it'd be very hard for me to do because I don't know how to do it. In the last 10 years, I've not done it. So in that way, I think if we are just honest to ourselves and then we honestly speak to our clients, they understand. And I've had, I've been very fortunate to have patrons or clients who have come to me for very mainstream consumer products or very high-end luxury brands. And I've said that, you know, that's not my zone. And whenever they have an NGO or an endeavor that's social or cultural, the same people have come back with wanting to work on that space. So I feel it's just the way you communicate and what you really, your intent is, because ultimately that's how you will communicate. So,
yeah. Thanks for sharing your, your thoughts today, Deshna. It was wonderful, listening to you, your projects that you've done. It was inspirational. And owing to the amazing work that you've done, we just want to, share our love and appreciation for those work. And we would want to confer upon you the title of Inspiring Young Designer. Thank you, Deshna.
Thanks, Kadambari. Thank you. This is generous. It's not for me. It's for the studio and the team. I, like I said, I only represent them. Yeah. Thank you.